Hi, I'm John Sicada. Did you know that chronic hepatitis C affects approximately 1 million Hispanic Americans? I'm visiting my father today, who's part of that statistic. And while not every story is the same, I'd like to tell you his. Such a proud man, old-fashioned, a provider, hardworking man. Stay strong, be silent. But this disease is just as silent. He lived with it for at least 20 years. He never mentioned how sick he was getting. Never talked over any of the options with his doctor. If I'd have known more about chronic hepatitis C, I could have encouraged him to take action sooner. Then maybe I'd be visiting him at home instead of here at the cemetery. If you still think there's strength in silence, think again. Please talk to your doctor about your options and learn more at tuneintohepc.com.
This Mental Health Minute is brought to you by the Guilford College Counseling Center. Care for yourself. The most common mental health concern for college students is anxiety, which can show up in a number of ways. Worry, irritability, muscle tension, and even panic attacks. Such symptoms can make it feel like you're not functioning very well. Research shows that relaxation practices such as deep breathing, mindfulness, and meditation can reduce anxiety. Moderate exercise can also be effective. Taking a brisk walk, throwing a frisbee, anything to get your heart rate up and break a sweat. Counseling has also been shown to reduce anxiety. A counselor can help you talk through your concerns and develop new coping strategies. If you are a Guilford College student and would like to speak with a counselor about anxiety or any other concern, you can call the Counseling Center at 336-316-2163 or email counselingcenter@guilford.edu. The Guilford College Counseling Center. Care for yourself.
Introducing the YMCA. What, you already know the why? Or so you think. Sure, you know the why for a swim, a workout, even a game of hoops. But did you know we're more than that? We're a cause. When you take your jump shot at the Y, someone else is getting job training. Take a cardio class while kids are in an after-school enrichment program. Practice your downward-facing dog as a teen practices her leadership skills. That's the Y. We work with people no matter their age, income, or background, and give them the opportunity to learn, grow, and thrive, all with one simple goal in mind, to strengthen our community. And we've got so much more that does just that. So while you might think of the Y as that place for lifting weights, we're also about lifting entire communities. Introducing the Y. We're so much more than a place. We're a cause. Visit ymca.net/more.
Back in the 1970s, rock and roll had become boring, predictable, and a chore to listen to. But the new wave movement began and changed all that. Bands like the Ramones, Talking Heads, Elvis Costello and the Attractions, XTC, and the Specials emerged and made rock music smart and fun again. I'm Ivan Seiler, and on Tuesday nights from 6 to 8 p.m., Gate City Backbeat will once again present the soundtrack for the revolution. I'll feature vintage new wave blended with the latest sounds that reject the monotonous and will move your spine in a new direction. Showcasing the best local talent will keep you moving all night long. On your only alternative, WQFS Greensboro, 90.9 FM and on the interweb.
Hey guys, this is DJ MJ, and this is the Guilfordian Hour.
Hi, I'm Jake, sports editor Jake. I'm here again.
I'm Bree, features editor.
And our guest today is our lovely opinion editor, Miles.
Hi, everybody. Name's Miles. I'm, like Jake said, the opinion editor at the Guilfordian, and I'm happy to be here.
Also an awesome. Early college student.
Oh, yeah, if you couldn't tell by the high voice, I still totally have like a freshman. Yeah. I'm an early college student, so I'm 17, which makes all the rest of you... I'll spare the words.
Yes, it's a good time. We've joked about it a few times with Sarah, because she's been on the show as well.
Yeah.
It's a good time. So do you want to tell us about the opinion section a little bit?
Yeah, so I've I've written for the Guilfordian for the past 2 years. I've only ever written one piece, not an opinion. It's like my home on the paper. So we don't publish like reporting stories like you see in News About a Nation or like the feature stories that you see in Features. We publish whatever the writer wants to talk about. So I've had articles about like social issues, addiction, about like events coming up that they really want people to be excited for, those sort of things. But really anything goes.
Sorry, we're getting like button clicks, technical difficulties as we always have on this show. Buttons.
But yeah.
Yes, sensitive mic. Anyway, so moving on from that, I guess we'll talk a little bit about spring break because this is our first week back. And then we'll get into the topic for today. And the topic for today is a fun one that I think we're all kind of struggling with, but we'll get to that when we come to it. How was your spring break, Miles?
Oh, you know very well. You were there. Yes. So my spring break was tiring. I spent the first half of it on tour with the college choir, singing in D.C., in Pennsylvania, in New York, and staying in New York for like a day doing whatever we felt like, pretty much, because they gave us a lot of free time, which was a good idea for some of us, a bad idea for others.
A very bad idea for some of us.
But then I got home, and of course, because I was up somewhere where it's colder than like 30 degrees, I immediately fell ill. Like an old Victorian child, I was laid out on my couch, back of my hand to my forehead, just like drinking orange juice and water with my robe on. So I was incapacitated for 2 days. And then at that point, by the time I was well enough to think more than like one sentence together, like string more than one sentence together, it was already like a couple of days before school started, so I had to do homework. So my break, if you can call it that, was busy and tiring and fun.
I agree.
Yeah, Bree, tell us about your experience.
The choir tour was an experience. I loved New York. Miles has some beef with New York. He prefers D.C.
If I may stop you for 1 second, so what you're saying is that of the trips you've been on, this was indeed one of them.
Yes, this was a trip. A trip.
We were certainly places.
It was a trip, and we'll go with that. But after I got back from the trip, I had to deal with a lot of friends stuff. It was a time. My break was a time. I'm hoping that other people's breaks were more positive than mine.
So yeah, my break, I'm not in choir, so I was not on the trip with you guys.
Ha. A shame.
Good job for you, buddy.
Yeah, mainly because I'm interning right now, so I was doing that and taking care of those responsibilities. So that and sleeping is really all I did. But Wednesday night, I did make it out to day two of the ACC tournament because it's here in Greensboro again. And we got to watch UNC take on Boston College. UNC won by about 20. Can't remember what the final score ended up being. Then we watched the first half of Virginia Tech and NC State, and that was fun. NC State could do no wrong. I don't think I've seen a more lopsided half of basketball, but it was a good time. I just slept through the rest of it, and, well, here we are. And our discussion topic of the day, which we mentioned earlier, is burnout.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I could speak for everyone else here, but I know I somehow came off that week-long break more tired.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
For all of us, I'm pretty sure.
I also just realized I'm rude. Maria, how was your spring break?
Oh, I'm rude. He's so burnt out and
forgot his co-host. How could he?
Technically, I'm his co-host.
Oh, really? Same.
It was a time, you know. My brother, he goes to high school, and all the kids at his high school managed to get, like, stomach flu. So I got stomach flu. So most of the time was me spent over a toilet.
Unfortunately.
Yikes. Yeah.
So what I'm hearing is nobody spring break went.
That seems to be the consensus, yes.
That is depressing.
Yeah, a little bit.
It also explains why we came back more burnt out than when we
left. I think everyone is. I don't think I've talked, even like professors who will sometimes, you know, they always try to say, come on guys, this is exciting. Like even they, I could tell it was, something missing.
Yeah.
They were like, come on guys, this is, like, they didn't believe it.
The first class I had back from break was calculus, and there's only like 8 of us, and like it's all early college kids, so ooh, your biggest fear. But we were all just staring at the board, just like, there are definitely figures up there. He's writing a quiz. Equations. Did they go in our heads?
Nope.
No, and he ended class early, I think.
I will say, the positive thing about the choir tour is the energy of the actual choir itself when we got back in Monday was really good. It was not good for Wendy because she was having to, like, scream over us, but it's definitely a lot more camaraderie.
The woman in charge of the choir, Jake.
Okay, just letting the viewers know.
Yes, Wendy Looker is the director of the choir, and she also does music there and stuff, but Miles came in late, so he probably didn't see that. But everybody was kind of interacting more. Way to
throw me under the bus here. Good lord.
But everybody was, like, interacting and, like, actually talking. It felt like a group, which was really nice. Like, I got to meet a lot of Miles' friends on the trip who I'm still friends with now. Like, I talked to a couple of them still.
Podcasting is not a visual medium, despite whatever Peter Loach says, but I'm staring daggers into his eyes like, right now for those who can't.
Speaking of the people viewing the podcast on YouTube, you should subscribe and hit the bell and read comments, because that's cool. And it gives me validation and makes in my brain, when I get the notification that you did it, my brain makes the happy chemical.
We need that serotonin to help with the burnout.
Please.
Lord.
Oh, speaking of burnout, come right for the Guilfordian.
Yeah. What a plug. Wow. You are just... Okay.
Yeah, we may have a story about it. You should come check it out. There's a link in the channel description.
We've probably had several.
Because YouTube does not let you put links in the video description. Until, like, you have to, like, verify something, and I've not done it yet. But if you go and click on the channel and you look under our bio and about us, you will find a link to our paper, and you can read our stories.
Okay.
Please do it.
Yes.
I'm not asking.
I'm not asking.
Hang on. Wait.
I'm
not asking.
Okay, there we go. Yes, just gotta have that additional effect when begging people to read our work.
So. That's basically what we have to do, so.
So true.
But in terms of the Guilfordian, we are looking for more than just writers. We're looking for people to help with web design, which Miles has been very big on recently, trying to get our website to look the best it can be.
When it's not breaking.
When he's not shattering the realm that is our website.
Yeah, I have a backup that y'all can publish whenever you need it, in case Miles breaks the website.
You mean because you did break it?
Miles breaks the website again.
I actually broke it earlier, ago, and no one noticed. It was a very small breakage. I'm not even gonna say what it was, because if you know, text me what the issue was, and I'll give you like.
If
a free
you
lunch.
Noticed the small
comment,
breakage.
Leave it in the comments if you noticed.
Yeah,
what
if
the
you
difference
noticed
is.
What the issue was, I think like yesterday, then I owe you lunch.
I don't. I wasn't on it enough yesterday. I was taking a mental health day, which got interrupted by.
Your mental health days never last more than like 2 hours. Let's be real.
Yeah. In terms of mental health days, that's supposed to be one of the ways you're supposed to combat.
Yeah,
burnout.
And combat burnout, and
it just doesn't work.
Yeah, also, I know Guilford gives us access to them. I'm not sure exactly. I don't think, from my understanding, you cannot just, like, call up a professor and say, I'm taking a mental health day.
My mom told me I don't think you can.
I don't think Guilford from my understanding, it's Guilford decides when we take a mental health day, and everybody takes it on that day.
Well, I mean, what I do is I just simply do not show up to class. What are they going to do? Grab me? Like, I'm at home.
Yeah.
And I never really run into, like, an issue of absence numbers, so I'm usually fine. But, like, for me at least, the Guilford professors are pretty nice. I'll just shoot them and be like, hey, look, I'm overwhelmed. I'm taking a day. And they're all pretty polite and like, okay. We'll
I try to take it on Tuesdays, because Tuesdays I just have a night class at 7 p.m. to like 10 p.m. So I'm like, I can sit and watch a movie. That's fine. It's online. It's not on campus.
Okay, I was going to say.
But
every Tuesday,
like in the last 3 Tuesdays, something has happened where I've had to come to campus. And I'm just like, why? Why you do this to me? It's a time. But... It's okay, Maria. I love you. But in terms of what are your other strategies besides like taking mental health days that you guys use to combat burnout? Or are you finding it to be just as big of a struggle because we're not given tools to help?
I'm not even going to cap. I just try not to think about it.
He's a denier.
Hey, that's honesty.
I will just tell him, like, oh, no, I'm him. Don't even worry about it. And just go on with my day. Eventually, it'll be over.
That's how that works.
So just keep walking through.
Miles is in denial.
We can all agree. I think the best way to combat burnout is just to make sure you never get to that point.
Yeah, and the problem is we've all made it to that point.
Yeah, the big thing I'll do, like especially when I'm working on stuff, just break things down. If you have a lot of like big assignments due like each week, or you have a lot to do, break it down into smaller goals and accomplish it that way. Don't just sit down try to do something in one sitting. If you're writing a paper, this is my advice. Either college students or, you know,
early
the people
college.
Listening.
High school
college.
Students, we exist too.
Yeah, that's right. I keep forgetting you do.
Sad.
Wow.
I know.
Tragic.
Yeah. What you do, break down, if you're writing a paper especially, just break down into what you want to talk about. Say, all right, I'm going to cover these two topics. So I'm going to take a break. Then you come back to it, you do the other topics. And you just break stuff up like that.
That's smart.
Like when I'm doing my, for those wondering about my internship, I do sales calls. And I'm supposed to do 40 a day.
You do seem like someone who does sales calls.
A little bit. You do have that timbre of voice tone, you know?
And the look. It's soul-crushing at times.
Yeah, soul-crushing.
And the way to avoid getting burned out with that, because I have to do 40 outgoing calls a day, that can be a lot. So I break it up into, like, 10 and 15 at a time. Like, okay, do about 10 or 15, get up for a few minutes, go do something, anything else, then come back and do it.
Yeah. So,
and doing it that way is way easier than if I just tried to, you know, zoom through it, fueled by nothing but Monster Energy and pain. Yeah. So,
pain.
Another thing.
Sorry, energy drinks, not any specific energy drink. They're not paying us.
No brand. No branding.
Brands mentioned. But
I did not name. I did not say any brand. You didn't hear that.
If you go back in the podcast, you won't see a brand.
No, you won't.
Like just blank airspace. But one thing for me is like I forgot where I read this. It was somewhere, probably on like a Tumblr post I saw on Twitter, screenshot from Reddit.
We love
the
rabbit hole of Reddit, Tumblr, and Twitter.
But a problem written down as a problem halved is whatever the quote may be. Someone can look that up in our research division that we totally have at the GoFordian. But so whenever
what if my arm gets chopped off? Well, I can't write it down.
We'll write it down with your other hand. But for me, whenever I feel like I have like 25 things going on, I'll just write them down in my to-do list.
That's
and actually getting
do.
Them out of your head makes you realize, oh, I can do that in a couple of hours. Like I've been to my calculus professor, if you're listening, I love you, Travis. I will get those problem sets done. I will get them done, I promise. But like they will be sitting in the back of my head like, oh, I have these five things to do. And I write them down. I look at the problems and I realize, oh, I'll get it done in like an hour or two. I haven't. It'll take me like 3 hours, Travis. I'll get it done soon, I promise.
I've recently started doing that. Like his Miles things with to-do list has kind of like bleeded into me the longer we've been working together. I now have like post-it notes I write to-do lists on. I just downloaded Notion. I have three different to-do lists on Notion. It is helpful, he's right, to kind of get it out and like in your brain, like you can kind of guesstimate. Like you're on a writing extensive college. At this point you should know how long it takes you to write a 2 to 3 page paper. So I can guesstimate like this will take me this amount of time. But in terms of burnout, I find myself getting more burnt out less by school and more by people. I didn't realize this was a thing until
That's
recently.
That's a crazy thing to say when all your friends are definitely listening and half of us are in this room. But continue about how people burn you out.
I'm not saying you guys. I'm not saying you. But okay, has anybody else like had this realization that you can get burnt out not just by like work and school?
Oh yeah, you need a break from people at times. That's why I go home on weekends.
That's why I completely.
I live here.
That's why I live home on every day. But yeah.
I'm a commuter, so I live at home. So it's like, it's not...
Yeah.
Where is that, like, place? Like, also, I can't get a mental health
also,
thing either.
I just want to throw this out there for our students listening. Procrastination is bad. You shouldn't do it. That leads to a lot of stress and
that
burnout.
That sounded like a really bad, like, don't do drugs, kids.
Yeah, the D.A.R.E. program
don't
is
do drugs,
reinstated
don't procrastinate.
By Jake, but
we
just
do not,
mid.
We do not endorse either of those activities.
Officially.
Yeah.
Officially.
And what about your burnout, Maria? How
we won't
do you
say
cope?
Which one.
How do I cope? A lot of sweets. I love candy.
That's a strat.
Yeah, and then I also crochet. I do have a lot of hobbies, my friends. I do crochet, I draw, and everything. I'm starting to learn how to sew, and everything that helps. And then just going around campus and walking around, listening to music, and completely avoiding people. Like, sorry if people see me, and I'm like. Pacing outside.
Oh, I do pace a lot. That does help.
And then I completely ignore them. I'm sorry.
Going on walks and music are very helpful.
Yeah, I've been doing that a lot.
I like walking into the woods, even though my roommate thinks I'm insane just walking by myself. And I'm just like, well, it helps.
Walking into the woods is a little bit into the wild core of you, but like
I
walking
mean, it's
in
the
general
Guilford
is good.
Woods.
It is
so
the
like,
Guilford woods, but woods are woods, man. But,
I got lost. I mean, that's true.
I got lost in there like twice, and then I forgot I had a phone.
Yeah, there will be times you're in that woods and you're like you panic because you're like in the woods and your mindset is like I'm trapped, I'm stuck, I don't know where I am, and then you're like wait, cell phones are a thing.
Yeah.
The other weird part about our woods that's kind of like disorienting is we will be you can be in the woods and you can't see like anyone else around you. It's just trees and just nature, but you can still hear like the road and everything going on. So it's just weird.
It is wonky.
The hardest adjustment I had when I first started living on campus was the adjustment to the noise, because even at night it's very loud.
Oh, really?
And I live out in the middle of nowhere, so I'm used to eerie silence.
I was actually surprised how much I liked the noise in New York, because I thought I'd be overwhelmed by it, but I actually really enjoyed it. I slept better in New York than I probably do here at home.
Can one of you two do an impression of it, please?
No.
Okay. It was worth a shot.
Yeah. Nice asking, but no. But no. I was the noise in New York was slightly soothing. Although again, we were a bit high up, so I didn't really hear much.
That was very high.
I mean, New York, it's built upwards, not outwards. So we weren't at street level exactly.
Yeah.
But like just the ambient, even going out like shopping at H&M where I bought this lovely sweater vest that all of the listeners can totally see.
It's a
really nice sweater vest. Take my word for it. It looks great with my outfit. Just even going out uber late. Yeah, I'll get a thumbnail. Going out uber late to go shopping, it still is just like a background loud city. It's not like somebody's yelling in your ear. It's just everything around you is just elevated in sound. It feels so odd.
Yeah, he does. I love it. Miles hates it.
I'm a DC person.
I liked Maryland, and that was close to DC.
Yeah.
You have crabs?
Huh? No,
crabs
are a big deal. We did go to a good coffee place.
I drove through Maryland a while ago with my family, and we saw a drive-through crab broil place.
Wow, like, that's cool.
You didn't even get out your car, and you got like a seafood broil. I was like, this is so Maryland. We didn't get to go in because we were, you know, not shopping for crab.
Man, do you have an address for this place?
That does sound pretty epic.
I wish I did, but shout out that one random drive-through crab place in Maryland. I don't know who you are, but
I have family.
You seem like you have family in Maryland.
Yeah, you do give that vibe.
No, they lived in Baltimore, too, and ooh, it was so funny.
Oh, that was two very different responses.
Yeah, Bree's ooh was happy. My ooh was ooh.
That's a big oof.
And one time, when we visited as kids, me and my sister, every time we would wake up, we would sing that song from Hairspray, Good Morning, Baltimore, and they were so annoyed by us by the end of the week.
I would have been, too.
As a musical theater nerd, I appreciate it.
To any of our listeners that may be in Baltimore, why ain't y'all paying Lamar yet?
That is a great question. I don't even follow NFL football that much these days, but I'm still a little bit confused as to what's going on over there.
Lamar, if you're for some reason listening to this radio station, please come to Carolina. We'll give you all the money.
I don't think that's true.
It's not all the money.
So we're just going to ignore the first round, like the first overall pick we traded up for just to get Lamar Jackson?
Oh, yeah, we did hear about this.
I believe it is an elaborate scheme to, we're going to trade back down and we're clearing cap space to get Lamar.
Honestly, I see it, but
I wouldn't hate it if they did it.
Wait. Would you want to clear cap, sorry, this is not sports talk. Would you want to clear cap space by trading away like your wide receiver, though, if you're trying to get a quarterback?
I mean, no, but that's where we are.
Jake.
Well, my thing is, they traded up for, like, the number one
pick, yes. Yeah. So they can have whoever they want.
And then, but they traded four people to get him. So they traded, like, four for one, and now
they traded DJ Moore
and
four picks.
Yeah, they traded one person and then four picks. But they can trade back down and get a person back in, like, five picks. You never know, right?
Yeah.
That's a little
what they gave up was, the Panthers gave up.
Politics of the sports world, I guess.
They had the ninth pick before the trade. They had the ninth pick. They gave up that, their second round pick this year, their first and second round pick next year, and DJ Moore.
Mm.
So, but in return, they got to move up to number one.
Lovely.
This year.
While we're on sports, Jake, who do you have winning March Madness this year?
That's the thing. I know very little about college basketball.
Yeah, so do I. But I still make brackets.
You make brackets?
I'm going to make one as well with my friends.
I know there are two people listening right now who I talked to earlier about making March Madness brackets. You don't need to know anything about basketball to make them. Just make them. It's fun.
My guess is Duke.
The people who usually go on a big streak and get really close to getting it right don't know anything about basketball. They just picked
teams. I should make a bracket.
You absolutely should. I think everybody on the Guilfordian should.
So should we make a Guilfordian bracket?
We should make a Guilfordian bracket.
That'd be very
bracket.
Funny. We
cool.
should.
That would
actually,
be
best
great.
Bracket win.
Who do I think's gonna win? I have not followed college basketball very closely, although I know what's going on with the ACC teams a little bit. I know.
Isn't Duke relatively good?
Duke is in the tournament.
Good.
They're not as
but
good as they usually are.
But they're not good enough to win? Question mark?
Okay, so for my brackets, I have Alabama winning on one, led by the star shooter Brandon Miller, and then I have Duke in another bracket because I always pick either UNC or Duke, and unfortunately UNC is not in the tournament this year.
That is correct.
Wait,
they
really?
Are not.
I know.
And they are not even. They were invited to the NIT tournament, which is for the teams who don't make it, and they turned it down.
Yeah. I will refrain from saying anything bad about UNC because I want to keep my admission. I have Duke as their choice. I mean, they're just not that good right now.
Somehow they bought a bunch of people back, and the chemistry got worse.
All I gotta say, if me as a person from Chapel Hill from near that college.
Yeah, unfortunate.
That was a sucky day. Yeah. Everybody was disappointed.
Yeah.
Wow.
But
so they're a football school now, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I have Alabama, Duke, and then I have Colgate as my sleeper from 15, which is going to look great saying I picked Colgate to win this.
All right. I don't think I'll get in trouble for saying this, but for reasons of comedy, I'm just going to say that Oral Roberts is going to win.
Oral Roberts is – oh, my God. No.
Yeah.
No, they're playing Duke in the first round. If Duke loses to Oral Roberts, I don't know what I'll do, but I'll do something.
Underdogs.
Not overdue.
Okay, okay, yeah. All right, Jesus.
If you want an underdog, it's gonna happen now. Or something, or VCU. Anyway, are we talking about sports? Is this a sports podcast?
No,
now?
It kind of became that for a few minutes.
Yeah, and I actually wanted to ask you because you brought up college admissions. Never mind.
Go ahead.
He gave me another glare, and I was like,
he gave those same dagger eyes that he was talking about earlier.
Yeah,
I was just wondering how that was going for you. Are you, like, exhausted yet?
I mean, I'm done writing stuff. I'm just waiting now. I mean, I don't apply anymore. Yeah, I have some schools that have let me in. Thank you to those schools. Some schools that I'm waiting on. Please let me in. I've already gotten into. I have Morehouse, UNC Chapel Hill, UNC Charlotte, and NC State.
Wow.
And then I'm still waiting to hear back from Duke, Yale, Columbia, and George Washington. If I missed any school on that list, feel free to bully me if you're an admissions officer for that school that I forgot. I'm so sorry. I love you still. But yeah.
Myself, Bree, and Maria all sat here in stunned silence. I don't know if you guys could see our face.
Yale,
these
Columbia,
names
that I'm
like,
waiting
dang.
On, which is probably not going to be. A
I mean,
yes,
I yeah. would bet that you make it into at least one of the ones you mentioned. I would bet
I mean,
on
I would,
one.
I think
probably
you
more,
good shot.
But you looked at me like
no,
concerned.
One is a good. I think at least one.
I think at least one.
I am
is
confident
fair.
In hearing back from one specific one that I will not say for legal purposes. But
I don't
other than
that's
that,
legal, but okay.
I don't know about the rest of them.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's still exciting.
It's very exciting now, but writing those essays, oh my god, it kills
yeah,
me.
Yeah, the application the process can be stressful, because I've been looking at grad school, because I'm a senior here.
Oh, grad school for what?
For what was that?
Sports management, which is my major.
That's so slay of you.
Looking at,
that's so slay of you.
Looking at the University of South Carolina.
The early college
ooh,
lingo
to, no, she didn't. Did
wild.
She? I think my sister did not go to you at the University of South Carolina, but it's a cool school, though.
Yeah, I went down to Torted in the summer. It was fun. It was really hot, but it was fun.
It was hot.
Yeah. Their women's basketball team is...
They're missing me back.
Is their men's team pretty good?
I think they are now.
Look, it's always going to come back to sports at me and Jake. I'm so
ooh,
sorry.
Ooh, you know, and this is actually an interesting side note. During the spring break college choir tour, we discovered something interesting about Miles that he had
I'm
not
so
seen
scared.
The Hunger Games series.
Oh, yeah, no, I don't watch movies or TV. I was a Mythbusters kid and a book kid, and I didn't read a lot of popular books either. So any like Disney movies, haven't seen them. Marvel movies, probably haven't seen them.
So Jake is also in that thing. But my thing was, we were watching The Hunger Games right outside of DC. We were watching The Hunger Games in the U.S. Capitol.
I don't get the joke.
It's bad.
Well, that is a book I had to read it for school.
You really?
Yes, I did.
That's really cool.
There are books about The Hunger Games? No, I'm kidding.
I was and, about to be like, Miles, I'm
well,
going to throw a book at you.
I'm joking.
I don't know if Joe's going to walk out and announce that tomorrow, but...
I'm
think
already...
if we got some 3D glasses, we could convince him it happened?
I guarantee you, we're going to have like an
that's
AI
that's the Transformers joke. But...
of The Hunger Games?
No, there's going to have like an AI video of Joe Biden announcing The Hunger Games on Twitter by like tomorrow.
That's right. Those
hey,
AI memes are really
have
funny.
Have y'all been
but
seeing those, by the way?
Yes.
What?
They're really funny, but they're really... It's kind of scary.
Yeah, it's like, oh, this is going to definitely cause some problems later, but right now...
Right now, it's a good time, you know?
Comedy. We just stray topics, don't we?
By the way, my
yes.
Comments about a certain person in a big White House do not reflect the values of the other people on this podcast or the school or radio station. Just throwing that out there. Someone
yeah, Jake,
is upset by
make
it.
Sure to put your legal disclaimers in every sentence you say. You scare me constantly.
It's mostly a bit. Sometimes.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's funny.
I can't tell.
If it does upset somebody, come after me, not my friends.
Oh, I will aww. Help you come after him. Cause I'm kind of curious.
Questionable,
anyway.
Questionable.
All I got to say is any FBI agent listening, please don't. Put us on a list.
Don't put us on a list for watching the
I'm
Hunger
probably
Games
already
outside
on one.
Of the Capitol.
I have done that. I am just a bystander that was invited
here's
in.
The
Miles
thing.
Is just an innocent
I've been
child.
Writing like I'm probably already on a watch list. I've
been
writing
been
like
doing?
A World War III novel for like 3 years. Some of the stuff I was...
Okay, now I feel like this is hurting my chances of college admissions being on this podcast. I'm kind of scared, but we'll
no,
keep going.
You're fine. You're good.
Interesting.
We were talking about Burnout.
We were
talking about Burnout.
We were supposed to be, at
so
least.
So we recently went to a conference where Marie and I learned about some things about, like, how to manage burnout. And I have a few things, like, so I have a few things that I actually, like, took note of. Very fancy, you know.
Wow.
So one of, like, the biggest tips that they gave was kind of figuring out your values and setting boundaries. How do you guys feel about that?
Just how do we feel about the concept of boundaries? A real tough question.
Well, no, because like some people struggle with it, like especially with like friends.
It's the hard balance. You want to be there for somebody or something like that, and it's just you're trying to do the right thing.
Yeah,
that movie.
It's putting other people above yourself, and that although that is like a selfless and very kind thing to do, it can lead to problems.
Yeah, Bree, if you notice me not responding to your text, that is why. You or your close friend. I'm not responding because I'm setting boundaries.
I haven't texted you, my guy.
Oh, if you text me soon, I will not respond. But yeah, that's it is a tough thing. But learning to say no to handling or getting involved in other people's things can be very
Oh, no, this is a boundary I've recently set. As of earlier today, I've recently as of recently today, I have set this boundary.
Yeah, there's been some backstage things going on that have been.
We aren't on a stage. We are
that have
on
led
the
to
air.
Some burnout, if I must say.
You remember how I said people can burn you out? Be very careful out there, friends.
But I was gonna say something about boundaries. Is like I think also the thing about boundaries is that it does take time for people to learn your boundaries.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah, because like my mom, like for me, for example, for my parents, for my mental health and everything, they learned how to like. It took a while, but eventually they learned not to cross the boundaries I have, or I'm going to go off and everything.
Yeah, I had that discussion with my mom recently,
too. We learned this in, like, high school, but I think, like, the sooner you've set boundaries at, like, a certain age, mm-hmm. the sooner, like, it'll be easier for people to set boundaries. Because when my parents see that I'm, like, on the edge, like, of, like, having a mental breakdown, mm-hmm. they're like, okay, let me back up and let me not get on her about things.
I talked about, because my friend from Iowa, who's a bit old, or I say a bit, a year older than me, Victoria, she just came back, and we were having this discussion. From, like, a young age, we're taught, like, that kind of looking out for yourself as being selfish, but then as you become an adult, you have to realize, like, there is a point in your life where you have to choose yourself. Like, I think that we talked about this with Sarah a little bit, too, that especially with the pandemic, in terms of mental health, there's a lot less stigma around it to an extent. And I think a lot of stuff that comes with that is burnout. Like, I remember back in high school, burnout wasn't a thing. Like, I had never heard of it before. I didn't even realize burnout was a thing that could happen until this year.
I thought burnout was only something that happened to YouTubers.
Yeah,
I mean, it's something that would be discussed. You'd hear that name, but, like, it wasn't something. It was just like, yeah, I am. I'm burnout. I'm not going to do anything about it, but I am.
Yeah, because that's what you would hear it mostly. Like, on YouTube. Like, YouTubers saying, like, I've been burnt out. I'm taking a step back. But
new Let's Play video coming next Friday.
I was in a dark place. That's the line they always use.
So you hear about this stuff on like YouTube and you don't really think about it. And then I feel like with this semester being like one of the first ones we've been back since the pandemic fully here. And this is the odd thing that I was thinking about. The way our like schedule is set up, like with the break, we come back from break and it's like 3 days or 3 weeks until finals.
Yeah.
And we did midterms right before break.
Yeah.
And then we start an entirely new class directly after. Did they not keep in mind, like...
Well, I will say, they are changing that schedule next
year.
Oh,
yeah,
that's
right.
95% sure that factored into why. Because it is...
That's right. This is the last semester of the 12 and 3 week structure.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
It will be 14, 14, 3 if I recall correctly from my emails that I read all the way through.
It sure will.
I love my emails. But no, it is a odd schedule, especially for us children, also known as early college students, because we're used to like traditional high school block schedule, semester to semester. We have like 8 A, B day, but that's about it. And then we come here, it's like, oh, you have one class for 3 hours every day. The second you get used to that, you now have three classes at a weird time. Back to three classes, you have midterms, go on break, finals, like what's a midterm exam? We don't know. Then we have another 3 week, and then we're back to the other system. It's a weird sort of jump for us.
It's also very, I don't want to say inconsistent, but like some professors want to have that like exam structure, and other professors do like final papers or projects. So you're either spending a bunch of time on a paper and a project on top of studying for three exams, or you just have like four different projects going on.
Yeah. Well, here, I know my experience is... We are very much an open-minded college where we don't do final exams. You just have to write like an 8-page paper.
I wish that was the
and
case.
That's what I've dealt with. That's what I've dealt with in most of my classes. And here's the problem with that. That's not a bad idea. But then you have to do like three of these at once. And when you're trying to do that, that can be very challenging.
Yeah, I mean,
and I believe the president just walked by.
Yeah,
that's kind of
cool.
Not Joe.
Kyle Fogarty, president of Guilford College, yeah. not Joe.
Not Joe coming to Slapdick. but no, I personally like it. I'm a big writery boy.
I am too.
So I love having like papers. Like I know last semester, like taking essays with Marius was great.
I love Marius.
Marius is, shout out to Marius.
We love Marius.
Like this semester, I was a little bit worried for how my exam system was going to look like. But I have rhetoric with Cynthia. It's a paper, like a final project, which, mm-hmm. shout out Cynthia. Love final, love writing for rhetoric. And then we have political science with Ken Gilmore. And it's another, it's like anti-research paper. So it's like it's a make a video game or some sort of game Ooh. Thing. It's going to be really, really fun.
That's cool.
And I have a calc exam for my favorite class in the world. Love you, Travis. I will do those problem sets. I promise.
That's the fourth time in this podcast. Yeah,
I know. I'm really thinking my time. I will get them done. Where it's an actual exam. So I have a good variety for me. So I'm not doing 12 papers, which makes it a lot easier.
I have Tracy, who is our current advisor. I have two projects for her, and then.
See you, Kyle.
Bye.
Bye, Kyle.
We love Kyle.
Who is our advisor at the Guilfordian? I have two final projects. Miles, stop. I have two projects for her classes that I have, and then I have a final paper for my film class. And then that's all I have. But these projects are... I'm confused.
For what
I don't
class?
Have a lot of details. African-American literature, like, I've read the syllabus, mm-hmm. and it says final project, and I've kind of read, like, the synopsis of what it's supposed to be, but I guess we're still doing midterm stuff, technically.
Ah.
So I'm just a little confused on, like, what is that gonna look like?
Yeah. One of the things I liked about my poli-sci and my rhetoric finals, or what is going to be my poli-sci and rhetoric finals, is that they aren't specific. They are vague. You figure it out. So, like, I have my own ideas I want to do, and I can just sort of do them, kind of the professors well, and they'll be like, yeah, sure. So, like, I prefer a vague assignment for when it comes to written things than a specific one, just because it gives me more latitude to, you know.
I agree.
Get funky.
I understand get that. Funky. I am the exact opposite, though.
You like a stricter...
I like the best thing, if any professors are listening to this, if you want to assign a final paper or something, please put on Canvas a PDF of one you think is good. So that way we can look at that and kind of know what you're looking for.
I mean, you're a senior. Boring. Don't you know how to, like, write a good paper?
No. I know how to write a paper. I know how to write a paper. But I don't know what someone's necessarily looking for.
That is true. That is
okay,
true.
That's
and that varies. That's the problem.
I have written papers that I thought were the worst thing ever put to pen besides.
Oh, yeah. I've done that,
oh,
too.
I've done
yeah.
that for sure.
But then they get a good grade, and then I write a paper. I'm like, oh, I'm the second coming of Ernest Hemingway, and it gets like a B, and I'm like, oh, my God.
Well, I did an annotated bibliography, and that was the Ooh. Only paper.
Warning
it was my English 101. English 101. It was like my final paper for that class, and I was so worried I tanked it, mm-hmm. and then I met with my professor about it. She's like, oh, you did it perfectly, and I was like, oh.
See, that avoiding, that's the big thing, because like you're talking about writing, you know, a paper you don't think's good. I remember in one of my classes, and during the 3 weeks we were talking about that, so this fits, and I mentioned procrastination earlier. I'm pretty bad about it still.
To-do list, man.
The class I was in, we had to write it was a science class. We had to write a 2.5 to 3 page paper like every 2 days.
Ugh.
About whatever we were talking about. And the first one, I waited, of course, it's 11:59 when it's due. I wait, of course, the last second. I start this thing at like 10 o'clock. Barely get it turned in. I'm thinking, man, this is really stressful. I don't want to do this anymore. I don't feel good about writing it. I got it back like 2 days later, and I got a 97 on it.
Whoa.
And I was like, okay, well, that's the best and worst thing that could happen, because there's no way I'm stopping now.
Yeah, although some of those, I've written some absolutely eloquent pieces of work at 11:58.
I gotta sit down and just charge through the whole paper with fueled by nothing but pain and energy drinks, you're going to get something. It's going to be, it's going to flow, because it's one train span of consciousness. But that comes with its own problems.
Yes,
it's
the structure is going to be.
What is it saying? It's a good question.
Yeah.
It's coherent. It doesn't say much of anything.
I guess just because I'm a creative writing major, I guess my mindset's just different for, like, papers.
Creative writing major?
I'm a creative writing major with a film minor.
Fascinating.
Yes, I'm a weird one, apparently.
A little quirky.
I'm a little quirky, for Guilford.
Well,
I guess not for Guilford, because it is a little bit arts.
Yeah, we have a lot of writing.
I'm thinking about double, like, minoring, because that's a thing you can do, in communications. I didn't realize double minoring was in existence. I knew you could double major. I didn't know you could double minor.
I guess that makes sense. I know, depending on the department, sometimes you can't double up and have your major and minor in the same department.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
I wanted to be a sports marketing minor, but they wouldn't let me.
Oh, interesting.
I'm going to have a field day trying to figure out whatever requirements are for whatever school I end up going to, which, again, if you haven't accepted me yet, please do. If you have accepted me, thank you. But I'll probably end up doing something like, I'll end up doing a double major of some sort or a major and two minors or some weird combination. So it's going to be a fun time figuring out what I can take and can't and have to and don't have to. But y'all stay safe, though.
That's always a process, finding out what you're
supposed to
take.
And some minors, like, take way longer to get into.
Mm-hmm.
I've noticed, because I thought about doing a minor in Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
Because I actually really enjoyed it when I was taking the class.
Uh-huh.
And then they told me, okay, well, you're too late in the game to get a minor there. This was last year.
That was
in the fall.
Weird.
I was like, okay. But then I declared for a business minor, like, spring of last year, like right before we went home for summer, and they're like, yeah, you could do it.
Well, I started with,
in fairness, I already had a course done for it, but
because for the communications minor it's very broad. So when I told my film professor that I was getting a communications minor originally, he was like, well, why don't you just switch to a film minor because it's a lot of the same requirements. So I switched to a film minor, but then I thought about it, I was like, if communications minor is more vague, I could just do both and have a vague and a more tuned in one. Because we've talked about columns a lot on here, and my column is a lot about critiquing pop culture and movies and video games, and I'm hoping to do a book review soon, which will be exciting.
Are you writing that, or are you having someone else write the book
review? I am going to read a book and then write a review on it.
Lovely.
I am excited about that. I'm hoping to get it done in the next couple weeks, but Miles, you've done a couple of columns. Sorry, they're doing some things with the mic, and I'm just concerned for
Miles. Yeah, I'm
making some adjustments.
My kneecaps were burnt out because these people had me standing, so I'm now kneeling on the floor. Again, podcasting is a visual medium at this point. I've come around to the idea, and I have the mic, like, angled downward so I can, like, sit on one knee and still speak at a normal, hopefully a normal volume.
Right. So you've had two columns, one focusing on Black philosophy and another one known as Miles Musings, which I think you've only done one story
for. I wrote two stories
for
it.
You wrote two.
Yeah. I'm changing that up now.
Oh,
again.
Yeah. Again.
Well, no, I need to make room for a final sort of longer-ish article. So I'm like, you know what? Columns are columns. I'll keep it there in case I need the tag to write about something that pops up in a given week. But yeah. But what about them, since you're asking me about
them? I was just asking you to, like, we were talking about burnout, and I was going to ask, like, is the reason you changed your kind of topic because of, you were kind of burnt out with the Black philosophy?
Oh, yes. There's only so many books you can read so fast.
True.
Jake is staring at me.
Get a little closer to the mic. Your levels are good, but they can be a little better.
A little bit like this.
Yeah, there you go. That's better.
Sure.
Okay.
But yeah, so it was, partially it was like, yeah, okay, I've written around this topic for like, I think about 5 articles, about as much as I could get out of it being like 12. I'm actually 17. So I said, you know what? I'm just going to move on. So that was part of the reason that I changed up my subject, was I was like, you know what? I don't have time.
To
learn enough to write more.
So, in terms of burnout, because we need to come, like, full circle back to that, we kind of talked about strategies, in terms of setting boundaries and values and all that fun stuff. I've recently started cutting my phone onto Do Not Disturb, so I only
phone
get...
Phone detox is a very good thing.
Yes, I made it so I can only get, like, direct messages and phone calls, and that has been a great experience for me. I don't know if you guys have tried that, but Do Not Disturb is a beautiful thing.
Yeah, it's fun. Also, I mentioned I'll do that most of my day. The fun part about a phone detox is whenever I do my yoga class, I'll just leave it outside, and that's like an hour of phone detox for the day.
See, my phone detox is just when I naturally lose it. I lose everything I own. Like,
that's true.
He's
lost his car to the basement so many times.
Oh, my wallet, according to Find My Wallet, is currently in the dirt somewhere on campus. I'll go find that after this meeting.
You're going to get your identity stolen.
Oh, it's definitely like, there are 5 different people using my social security number in like 5 different countries right now at this point.
Oh,
Miles,
my God,
we have basically given the viewers a side quest now.
Yeah, if you find my wallet, you can have all of the money that I definitely keep in there. As long as you return that, don't laugh, I'm not that broke. As long as you return my Quicker card and then my credit card and then my debit card. You keep the cash though, and the Polaroids. I want to keep my Polaroids. Don't take
those. Oh yeah, the Polaroids. He has like a picture of his girlfriend and it's really, really cute.
Mm-hmm.
I love that was genuine. I love your girlfriend. She's
yeah,
really
she's
sweet.
Great.
He's glaring at me.
I'm glaring at her again with a
spare time this afternoon. You could just walk around campus to find a wallet and steal Miles' identity.
Yeah, side quest. And money. And money. Just give me back my Polaroids, please. Side quest.
It's really cute. Why are you glaring at me so much today?
I just feel like glaring.
Okay, sure. I think he's mad at me, guys. Mm. It's fine.
People can really burn you out, can't they? Anyway, on with the podcast.
Nothing. But we're moving on from that in terms of burnout for school. Do you guys communicate with your professors about like how burnt out you are? I know you said you did.
Oh yeah. I email my professors. I'm like, hey, I'm just not gonna be there. Lol. Most of them are okay with it. I had one professor who was like, actually I prefer you be there, and I was like, oh. So I showed up to class that day. So I'm very easy. Again, college admissions officers, if you're listening to me, I'm very responsive to my professor's demands. If they ask me to be in class, I will definitely be there. I'm really plugging my admissions stats.
You really are, and I appreciate it.
You put in the work. But
he also likes long walks on the beach with romantic.
Yeah, with AP exams or whatever. But yeah, so I just email my professors, and they're at Guilford. They're really, really chill, and they know me as someone who tries to do their work to the best quality possible. I'm winking towards the microphone. You can't see it. So they let me pretty much, if I need a day off, which I need on occasion, just not show up.
How often do you take like a day off? Because I think I've only heard you doing it once.
If I'm taking a day off, stuff is wrong. I'll take a hard day off, like a whole day or two, maybe like once a blue moon, really. But I will occasionally say, you know what? I'm too tired for this class. I'm miming typing now. Type up an email and say I'm not going to be there, and just don't go there. Like maybe like once every like 5 or 6 weeks. So not that often.
That's fair. Jake, what about you?
Usually the communication will come like in class because they'll say something to the effect of, "You guys seem tired and kind of burned out," and I'm like, "Yeah, I am." And they're like, "Okay, moving on."
Oh no.
That's usually how it goes. If I do miss class, I will. Usually, I've only missed class because I'm sick. That's the only time I've missed
class. Yeah, aww. I rarely ever miss class.
There were some times, I think, last semester.
It's really fun if your professors are
cool
with it.
I wasn't feeling great, and I was just really burned out and didn't want to deal with the class, so I just didn't go. And I emailed and be like, hey, I'm dealing with something, can't go. I've never had the confidence to tell them burnout why I wasn't
there. Because, like,
I just say I'm unwell. Like, I'm just unwell. I need a day. Sorry. I will be there. I put so many sorries in my emails.
Because, like, we mentioned this, like, in terms of Guilford, like, my mom told me to email my professors and be like, I'm burnt out, I need a day. But I was like, I don't think we can do that. And I don't know why we can't do that, because I feel like, and I've given this advice to my friend, I was like, I feel like your professor or your boss would want you to take the time.
It's become a lot more common and acceptable.
Yeah, definitely.
Would take the time and do better work than attempt to go to work burnt out.
Yeah.
Or mentally unwell.
My mom gave me the confidence to do that, because whenever I was a little kid, if I just told her I didn't want to go to, and she told me this at the beginning of like every school year semester, like, hey, if you don't want to go to school, just tell me. I'm not going to ask. You're not going. I would just like, just not go.
That's a good merit.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't get sick often. And my teachers, again, liked me because I was fun to have in class. So I didn't ever rack up absences. But if I needed a day off, I would just take a day off. So coming into Guilford,
maybe
I was like,
I should do that more often.
Yeah, so coming into Guilford, I was like, oh, I need a day off? Well, I will not be in class. Sorry. And then I come back to class the next day. Like, oh, what happened? I'm like, oh, I just needed a day. And like, oh, I'll do my work and I'll make up for it and it will be fine. So as a youngin who grew up in like the modern conception of you could take days off, it's really not that difficult.
When I was in high school, we were
in the 1990s or 1980s, like during the Reagan era or like
2019.
Nixon? Ooh, how was that? Were things in color back then, or was it still black and white?
It was still one room.
Let's relax here.
Okay, my fault.
They gave us 5 absences for each class. Like, you can have 5 absences.
Oh, yeah. That's
yeah.
But the way they always said was, like, this is so if you get sick or if you just need a day. Like,
they said
treat it like vacation days. That's the way they always told us to be.
Okay, it was never vacation days, but it was, like, if you need a day, take one of these 5. You have 5.
Maybe it's because my high school was an arts high school, but it was also an all-honors high school.
All-honors arts high school is crazy.
Like, there was no average, like, level classes. You either took honors or AP, and you had a major. You were, like, your art was your major. So it was a very intense schooling program. I was a chorus major, a vocalist.
Fits.
Okay, Jesus.
What do you sing?
I mean, I do sing. That's true. I still sing now, but I didn't realize how burnt out I was on singing from just that entire experience until
even something you really enjoy, you can get burned out.
Yeah, like singing was like a passion and a hobby of mine, but that entire like schooling process, like we did a whole musical theater show. Usually you do like 6 months to a year to prepare for like doing shows. We did it in 3 months and did a number of 3 shows, and then the pandemic happened and everything shut down.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous.
But I know a lot of kids who like, I went to, over the summer, I went to governance school, like, ooh, which is, it's fun.
Oh, it's fun.
I went for social science. So we just like learned about like criminology and stuff.
Oh, it's, okay. That is cool.
For those who are listening who don't know what it is or you're not from North Carolina, like every summer, like the NC Department of Education, whatever, will like, you apply for it and they take like, I think about like, the like 200-ish nerd students who are juniors, and they say, okay, go to summer school, but for like nerds. So you like, you nerds. Learn about what you want to learn. You pick your like area one is what they call it.
Oh, cool.
And they had area ones for like choir and like instrumentation, all that sort of stuff. So we got like to have like performances by the students there.
That's really
but
cool.
Like, I remember the natural science students, mm-hmm, who are doing a difficult subject, natural science. Yeah. Like, that's their thing. But a lot of them were like really stressed out in past years, not when I went, because they kind of adjusted for that.
Yeah.
Because they had so much work, because you're there for like 6 weeks residential. So you're doing just nonstop research on stuff. And even them who are like, these are like the nerdiest science students you will find in North Carolina, period. Even they were sick of it after a little while, because like, mm-hmm, it's a lot. So it doesn't matter how much you like the thing you're doing. You do it too much, you're gonna get sick of it.
Yeah, that's true. And that's why me having hobbies, I have a lot of them, but it's so hard for me to maintain a hobby because I'll do it till I get burnt out on it, which is unfortunate.
Yeah,
that's kind of why I think I've mentioned it before that I used to run track here. It just,
you ran track?
Yeah. I did.
What distance? All or like 100? Like,
I ran 100? I was a 400-800 guy.
Ooh, is that, wait,
and then
is
that
400? That is, they're all impressive. It's track.
Well, I kind of fell in the no man's land between distance and mid distance.
Yeah, but I don't know many people who do 400-400-800.
Yeah, because for those that don't know, in college, the way they usually split it up is your sprinters are 400 and lower, your distance people are 401 and up, I guess.
Yeah.
Anything above that. But, so, if you're like me, and you kind of fell in the 4 and 8 category, there really wasn't anywhere for you.
Oh, no.
And I also went from, you know, high school tracks only 2-3 months at the most. And then
it's
I
like
had
a
to do...
spring sport, isn't it?
It's when it's warm enough to run.
Yeah, it's a spring sport. Yeah. It starts in February. Like, I know for my high school, it started in, like, late February. Usually ends in mid-April, mid to late April.
Aggressive vibration.
And the way that would usually go was we would go through it and we get done. Then you could switch to whatever sport you played in the fall. I played football. And that was always fun to have that switch up. And then the winter, I didn't do anything, so I had a break. Whereas now, when I'm in college doing it, I went from in the fall doing cross country, which I had no interest in doing, but was forced to do.
Shout out Austin. I know him. He's my friend. He does cross country running. He's a great guy.
Good for him.
Is this the Austin I may or may not have heard of? I don't recall.
You probably have. I talk about him on occasion. He's cool.
Yeah, I've heard of him in passing.
He's one of the few like running people I know that is happy, which is great for him.
Yeah, most the way it would go was we went from doing cross country in the fall, which I had no interest in doing, but they made me do it. And then we would switch from like, you have like a week in between cross country season ending and indoor track starting. So, and then after that, you switched outdoor. So there was just no stopping.
Yee.
And going through that process a few times was just so rough.
Yeah, burnout, I feel like, happens a lot easier than I think we all, like, think about it. Like,
yeah,
in retrospect.
Really.
Oh, denial. Denial.
I will keep denying it. I'm fine.
This guy, I will tell you, on one of our last days of our choir tour, he woke up so, like, he didn't sleep the night before, I guess, but he woke up mad.
Oh, I was so
he was
grumpy.
Livid, and I was like, the entire day I was like, grumpy Miles,
yeah.
Like, man, you need to sleep. And then he slept for like 4 hours.
Yeah, I mean, it was fine. I'll talk for a little bit about this while they read their messages.
We're not reading messages.
But it was fine. I do get contrary to popular belief, I do get burnt out. I just won't talk about it. I'll take a day when I need it. The only time it becomes an issue for me is when I don't have time to take days.
Yeah.
Like, I could have been burnt out so many different times in the first semester or this semester.
Oh, yeah, the first semester, if I would have been burnt out, totally fine.
I would take a day off, right? It becomes an issue when you have so many overlapping things that there is no days off to take, and you're sitting there like, oh,
like,
okay.
Like, this is literally the worst time for us to be burnt out.
Like, I planned, like, I knew I was burnt out the entire second half of the first part of the spring, but I planned for spring break to be my sort of days collective off. And then they weren't. So I was grumpy.
So, like, because we all kind of expect spring break to be that kind of time in between. But for some reason, like, for us especially.
For very identifiable reasons.
For, no, but just, like, being on tour, like, aside from those other reasons, being on tour and, like, singing and performing.
Yeah, it kept you going.
It kept us going. And we also had early call times. We had to, like, it's a very quick thing. We're on, like, a literal tour. And that was the first 4 days of our break. So by the time we got back, we had half of our break left.
Yeah.
Miles got sick. I fell ill.
It was more Jane Austen core.
And then, like, it seems like a lot of people either got sick or had their own problems. Because, like, during spring break, also, like, this is the time to kind of get back together with friends, and sometimes...
It's a time to relax. You don't want to lose your rhythm. That's one thing I'll say. You don't want to get out of rhythm, but at the same time, you need to also take a break. So, like, if you're one of these professors if you're a professor or a teacher in the public education system that's lower than us, if you assign a packet for spring break... You are the worst person in existence.
Yeah. Shout out to my professors and the early college teachers, because I think they respected our break very, very well.
Thank God. Our professors, I had a paper due.
Yeah, mine are pretty good. In college, I've not dealt with that.
I had to deal with it over this break, over a couple of the breaks. People have, like, had papers due, like, the Monday back from break, and I'm like, are you serious?
Yeah. Although part of that can be your own doing, like me, because I planned on being healthy in the latter half of spring break, so I had problem sets I had to do. Again, love you, Travis, I'll get them done, that I planned to do over break.
Yeah.
So I'd had no work, but I made work for myself that I just could not do. I'll get them done soon. So that also became an issue. So it's not just like, oh, your teacher assigns you work. Make sure that you clear your own schedule before your break. Don't end up accidentally trying to catch up on stuff.
My plan was I was going to do this paper on, like, Sunday right before school. Because it doesn't take me long to write a 2-3-page paper. But by the time I hit Sunday, I was still so exhausted from the rest of spring break. I was like, I'm going back to school, but I'm still tired. It's like I had no break. Which is just, it's wild how that has kind of become the general theme, I feel like, that even over our breaks, we're still, like, working.
Yeah, like, there is no rest from certain things.
Yeah.
You have to really make that rest, which is...
Where setting boundaries comes in.
Oh, we love boundaries.
And setting boundaries and getting rest helps you not get burned out.
Yes.
So true, King. But yeah, so it was a fun break. It was a fun break,
but it was a
exhausting one.
It was...
Yes. Also, doesn't help that our first days back have been very cold. We're having very nice.
God, it's frigid.
We were having very nice, like 70-degree weather before we went home, and then we came back. And yesterday, it's been like 40. It's 40 degrees and windy.
Yeah, we went up north, and it was like brisk up north. Is that the right word?
Brisk isn't acceptable.
Okay, well, brisk was a good word. But
good.
I like something about like New York cold compared to North Carolina cold. Is so vastly different to me, and I hate North Carolina cold.
Yeah, New York cold was like, New York cold catches up on you, but North Carolina cold, you feel it when you walk out the door.
Yeah, you like, it chills you to your bones in North Carolina, and I am not a fan of it, to be honest. I've never been a fan of the cold, but I prefer North cold than I do South cold.
This is why D.C. is one of the best cities, I'm just saying.
Anyway. I mean, I enjoyed D.C. for the little amount of time we were there.
Yeah, and the weather wasn't that bad either.
The weather was not terrible. I liked D.C., I liked Maryland. Philly and Pennsylvania was a little average to me.
Yeah. But that trip helped a little bit, but
I think it was a great experience.
It was a lovely experience. I would have loved if I could also have been healthy afterwards and took some time to sleep.
But that's mainly what I did during break was sleep.
Lucky man.
It's the classic where you go to sleep, like you sleep a long time, then you wake up and you're somehow more tired.
Yeah, I did that. I think Sunday. I slept a full 8 hours on Saturday and then slept all of Sunday. That's why I didn't get my paper done. Because I was that tired. Like, burnout, it doesn't just affect your mental health or emotional health. It affects your physical health. We're all struggling.
It's a very serious topic that we all work on.
We try our best.
It's a struggle out here.
But yeah. Cool. Jake said words.
Alrighty, I believe that we're ready to go. That will conclude our show for today. Thank you all for listening in and those watching on YouTube.
This has been Bree, the features editor.
This has been Jake, the sports editor.
This has been Miles, the opinion editor. Thank you all for having me, by the way. This is a great visual medium. I love podcasting.
We love podcasting.
And this has been DJ MJ. Thanks for listening, guys. Next up is Beck. And thank you guys for listening. And please check out the Guilfordian website and all that. And have a great day. Bye-bye.
The sounds of the instruments, the acoustic instruments, and the instruments that make up the music of bluegrass.
Rhonda Vincent for Bluegrass Music.
The real sounds of the wood. The combination of the harmonies. To me, that's the realness of bluegrass.
Discover what's real. Discover bluegrass.
Discover Bluegrass on the Old Country Store every Saturday morning from 8 until 10 with your host Roy Moore on your only alternative, 90.9 WQFS, Guilford College Radio. The night we fell
in love. We don't know what's going on with our daughter. We're worried that she might be drinking or taking something else. My husband saw cans and bottles in the back of her friend's car, but we don't know how to talk to her about it. She's been keeping her life a big secret. I was uncomfortable when a friend asked me how our daughter's doing, so I pretended everything is okay. And realized that now I'm keeping secrets too. My therapist suggested we try Al-Anon family groups. I'm glad we took her advice. It helps to talk with people who understand what you're going through because they've gone through the same thing. Are you troubled by someone's drinking? You might be surprised at what you can learn in an Al-Anon family group from people just like you. Call 1-888-4-Al-Anon or visit alanonfamilygroups.org.
This Mental Health Minute is brought to you by the Guilford College Counseling Center, Care for Yourself. It can be difficult to know whether your use of alcohol or other substances is problematic. After all, you might know people who use more than you do, but they seem just fine. Here are some questions to help you gauge. Have you tried unsuccessfully to cut down? Have others expressed concern? Has your use interfered with obligations at school, work, or elsewhere? Has your use caused health or legal problems, yet you continue to use? If you answered yes to any of these questions, it would be a good idea to check in with a mental health professional. The Guilford College Counseling Center.